good YouTube, welcome back to JY's Adventures. You guys are the best, you guys are amazing. Remember, you can accomplish anything you put your mind to. You guys showed me a lot of love on the Banana Splits movie How to Beat video. So we're gonna check out the Banana Splits kill count video. More cinema summary reactions definitely coming. More How to Beat videos on the way. You know what I'm saying? Dead Meat always putting out fire videos. So we're going to see what we got in this one. If you're new to the channel, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, hit that notification bell. Let's get this video to 100 likes. I really appreciate all the support that you guys give me, fam. It really means a lot. Without any further ado, let's go.
Dead Meat.
Welcome to the Kill Count, where we tally up the victims in all our favorite horror movies. I'm James A. Janice, and today we're looking at the Banana Splits movie, which premiered at Comic-Con in 2019. The Banana Splits movie is based on the Banana Splits Adventure Hour, a Hanna-Barbera jam created by Sid and Marty Krofft that originally aired on NBC from 1968 to 1970. Not gonna lie, I had never heard of this show before this movie came out, but Chelsea was familiar with it, so what the fuck do I know? The show featured the same anthropomorphic furries that are in this feature, and they were in a band, and they would introduce various segments that mostly consisted of cartoons. Cool! How the fuck did this become a horror movie? It may have something to do with Five Nights at Freddy's and its perpetually postponed film adaptation. I guess originally, Warner Brothers was going to make the Five Nights movie, but the rights went to Blumhouse instead. And so Warner Brothers, under their subsidiary Blue Ribbon Content, decided to make a different movie featuring murderous animatronics, and they based it on the Hanna-Barbera show because the Banana Splits characters were already kind of off-putting.
I think that a lot of children's television is innately creepy.
For what it's worth, I think the result is a fine slasher. The writing's a bit forced at times, and there's some wonky editing here and there, but I appreciate the tone it manages to hit. It's cheesy, but not saccharine, self-aware, but not cynical, and funny, but not mean-spirited. Plus, it's got some crazy good gore, so much so that I can't put it all in the public version of this episode. And hey, the score was composed by Patrick Stump from Fall Out Boy, who also did an awesome cover of this earworm of a theme song.
I felt it coming.
And that's not the first time this song was covered by a rock band either. In Kick-Ass, there was a version done by the Dickies, the band that did the iconic Killer Clowns theme. If you want to tra-la-la and have a good time with this movie, though, you're gonna have to buy into it. Which mostly means accepting that the Banana Splits characters are completely mechanical animatronics, even though they're clearly played by people in suits. But come on, just go with it, because then you get to see stuff like this. That's totally worth it. Let's go on and get and meet the Splits, because it's time to get to the kills.
Let's see them body bags.
The movie begins with a TV show opening that introduces us to all the members of the Banana Split show. There's a doofy dog named Flegel, a crazy ape named Bingo, a lion named Drooper, and a cute elephant named Snorky. Am I forgetting anyone?
And featuring Stevie.
Aw, shit, of course, Stevie. Guys, I would kill to play Stevie. The Banana Split show is beloved by kids everywhere. Like Harley here, whose favorite member is Snorky. He's even got a costume of the Trunky Bastard. For Harley's birthday, he and his family are going to a live taping of the show. The tickets were bought by Harley's mom, Beth, much to the disappointment of Harley's dad, Mitch, who thinks that Harley is too old to be into this kind of thing. But I don't know, man. Kid's got a unicorn on his cake. Seems like the right age demo to me. Joining Harley for his birthday adventure is his half-brother, Austin, son of Beth but not of Mitch, whose best idea for a birthday present is an umbrella without the umbrella part, and a girl from Harley's school named Zoe called in as a seat warmer when Harley's only real friend got too sick to go.
But that show's for babies.
Oh, and suddenly you're so mature. You have bunnies on your undies.
Blast! Bested by the bunnies once more. They arrive at the studio and drive to the back of the lot in a long sequence with a lot of ADR.
The Banana Splits is me and Austin's favorite show. Really?
I'm sure she really loves the show.
I hope Snorky does the Snorky Shuffle. It's so funny.
He He's totally gonna do it. He does it every time.
Why is this segment so long? We meet some other wacky characters, also there for the taping, that include Dadager Jonathan, who wants his daughter Parker to be a star, and Thad and Poppy, the type of social media influencers who make me hate it when I'm called a social media influencer. The woman in charge of herding these crazy cats is the studio's Paige named Paige, who Austin kinda hits on, but in a cute, awkward way, which seems to work. I think she's on the same page as you, Austin. The banana splits roll up in their little banana buggy and nearly run over Harley. Like, what the fuck are your survival instincts, kid? They drive away from their fans and march their mechanical asses into a workshop where their inventor and maintenance man, Carl, chastises them for almost hitting a kid. He gives Drooper a painful-looking update, during which a random programming error turns the code a scary red color. But even though inside his heart is breaking and his faux fur may be flaking, Drooper's smile still stays on, because the show must go on. While that Carl guy is the dude who created the Banana Splits animatronics, this Rebecca lady is the person who runs the Banana Splits show. That is, until network exec Andy tells her that the show is hashtag canceled. What, did Flegel say something racist? The show's cancellation is kind of the catalyst for the whole movie, but I've gotta say, Andy sounds like he's making it up on the spot when he explains why he's axing a show that apparently still gets good ratings.
Yeah, but it's old and stupid. And I want to do something cool and edgy, so today's your last show.
The final live show gets started, crowd is treated to a bunch of wacky hijinks, until Drooper misses his cue to come on stage, which means Stevie, the baddest motherfucker around, is gonna have to cover for him.
We have to get Drooper out of Mr. Waldershite's fence. Again.
Haha, great work, Stevie, yeah!
That man dressed like a child?
Well, yeah, but...
That's Stevie. Nobody really likes him.
Hey, nobody really likes you, Harley. How about that? One of the show's segments is a game straight out of Double Dare called Sloppy Time.
It's Sloppy Time.
And it looks like they made them extra sloppy for you. They know how to use kids like them sloppy. Yo, and by the way, Carl must be a genius. That is some sophisticated AI to be throwing them prize like that. Obviously, in real life, the Banana Splits were played by people in suits. And director Danishka Esterhazy decided that, instead of actors or even stunt performers, she wanted dancers to play the roles, to best mimic the movements of an animatronic. So shout out to the dudes underneath these clunky ass suits. Terry Sauls, Buntu Plam, Corey Clark, and Brandon Bragum. It takes a lot to perform wearing cumbersome costumes like that.
Those things are so hot. I don't know how they're doing it all day. They're really like the heroes of this film, I think.
One of the kid competitors takes a plunge into a ball pit and uses a hammer to win the game.
She took it down to Hammertown.
If that voice sounds familiar, it's because all three of the Speaking Splits characters were voiced by Eric Bauza, a Canadian voice actor who's done a ton of work and is currently the voice of Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, Marvin the Martian, and other major Looney Tunes. Those are not easy roles to get.
That's
and because
fire.
I love watching voice actors do their thing, I just want to commend Bauza on all the voices he does here, like how he replicates Alan Melvin's southern drawl for Drooper.
For his voice, you know, he kind of had the Droopery kind of voice, so we kind of have that southern drawl, very slow, and that's what we did.
Does a Ross Perot-ish twist on Dawes Butler's voice for Bingo.
And for that, he was, you know, again, much more high-pitched, again, a little bit of that weird southern drawl.
And does an excellent imitation of Paul Winchell's Tiggerific voice for Flegel.
The amount of power and energy that he brings to this character, and then the sloppiness of it all. I don't want to spit on you.
As for Snorky, he doesn't
amazing.
Talk. Deal with it! Paige goes to Stevie's dressing / janitor room, where she finds him lounging inside, looking like a McPoyle. He's drunk and angry because he's fifth billed on the show and gets no respect.
They wait for the puppets. They can wait. Me.
Don't you worry about Stevie there, Paige. I mean, look at him. He's the spitting image of professionalism. On his way to the stage, Stevie overhears Andy saying that the show has been canceled and that the animatronics will soon be decommissioned. He walks away, looking way too happy about his imminent job loss, but I guess it's because he's excited that the puppets will soon be no more, since after he returns to the stage for the show's big finale, he whispers to Drooper that his days are numbered. Drooper spins the wheel of endings, which, as always, lands on Rockout. And let me just say, I am living for Stevie's sweaty, drunken dancing montage. Yeah, also, heads up, the Tra-La-La theme song will fucking burrow itself into your brain. You've been warned. The show ends, but there's a special backstage tour.
Definitely burrowed in my brain as a kid, okay? Every time it came on Cartoon Network, fam. OG days, fam. Classic.
You've been warned. The show ends, but there's a special backstage tour awaiting some of the guests who had stars on their tickets. There weren't any stars on Harley's ticket, but Austin is a great older bro and convinced Paige to help him give Harley a birthday surprise. So he gets to be the innocent Charlie Bucket of this wonkin' adventure. Harley Bucket? Backstage, Stevie tells the very regimented Banana Splits gang that their show has been canceled. And since he hated working with all of them, why don't they get a taste of this? Drooper ain't about to put up with that disrespect though, so Stevie becomes our first victim on the count when Drooper sticks with a giant lollipop down his throat. I wonder what flavor that cherry. Yep, looks like cherry. But yep. Try to eat it a little slower next time, Stevie. Tomatoes. During the backstage studio tour, Austin tells his mom that Mitch, his stepdad, fucking sucks. I mean, the guy's not even here with them on his own son's birthday, having stepped away to do business stuff on his phone. But wait a minute, that's not business stuff. That's PG-13 sexting between Mitch and his assistant.
There's hundreds of these.
Wow, man, hundreds and you're still getting bra pics? Why y'all taking that sexting so slow? Afraid of viruses? Austin comes outside and confronts Mitch, who
better be careful about the cloud uploading them to the cloud.
Sexting so slow. Afraid of viruses? Austin comes outside and confronts Mitch, who leaves his wife and stepson with a very optimistic outlook on the situation.
Guess whose night just freed up?
Yeah, that's definitely one way of looking at it. Inside, the tour has fallen apart almost as quickly as Beth and Mitch's marriage, with Jonathan running off to find a producer to look at Parker, Paige chasing after them, and Thad and Poppy leaving to go explore the rest of the studio, you know, for the gram. That leaves Harley and Zoe to meet the Banana Splits by themselves. But even though Drooper's a cool duders to them, Harley really wants to meet Snorky, who's nowhere to be found. He's too busy outside, stalking down cheating husband daddies. Jonathan finds Rebecca and, believing her to be the producer who can make his dreams come true, tells Parker to begin their rehearsed routine.
What you gonna do with all that junk inside your trunk?
Stop.
That is disturbing.
Rebecca tells Jonathan to get the hell out of there, because not only is that borderline child abuse, there's also no more show for Parker to be a part of. But Jonathan won't take no for an answer and goes off to look for someone higher up.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thad and Poppy pass by Snorky's Circus and Bingo's Jungle so they can step onto the stage of Flegal's Magic Shop. All of these sets were created by production designer Bobby Cardoso, who had a great time making TV shows sets that could be shown in their entirety, since this movie pulls back the camera and lets us see the whole soundstage. He was especially fond of the playing card spirals on Flegal's Magic Stage here, which is the perfect place for Thad to strike up a live stream and do the one thing I knew I would never do to Chelsea, propose in front of a live internet audience. But you know what? It works for Poppy.
Thad, yes!
Yo, she said yes!
So great, these two are good for
the likes and the clicks, y'all. Yeah.
Too bad Flegal is here, and he doesn't like people trespassing on his magic stage or live streaming his secrets.
Banana Catabra!
Presto Destructo! Fuck your phone! Flegal pushes Thad into a magician's box and locks him inside, then forces Poppy to assist him as they reenact that kill from Leprechaun 3 by sawing the magician's assistant in half. With a final push of the saw, Thad is properly killed, which you can tell because he has blood coming out of his mouth. I don't think Poppy's a fan of the trick, but I'm a fan of this movie's practical gore, which Warner Brothers exec Peter Girardi, who helped put this movie together, championed over using CG.
All of the original property of the Banana Splits was all practical, so we wanted to keep that practical nature of it. We wanted it to kind of be true to that era, true to that kind of filmmaking.
Poppy tears off Flegal's arm flesh, but before he can kill her, he's distracted by the sound of children, since Harley and Zoe are now strolling through the Snorky Circle. circus. Flegel offers to take them to meet Snorky, and even though he's got a scary Terminator arm, shit man, this kid needs to have some elephant. So let's go! Jonathan finds the office of Andy the network executive, and is all ready to deliver his Parker pitch, but the only one there is friggin' Drooper, who stands up and blows a bunch of fire into Jonathan's face. Not the best fire effects here, but I do think it's pretty hilarious how Drooper stands there dancing as this guy's face skin melts off. And then Bingo kidnaps your daughter? Not a good start to showbiz, dude. Outside, Snorky finally decides to openly harass Mitch and chases him through a little ditch thing that the dude obviously should have just jumped out of. Mitch runs all the way to the entrance of the lot where he finds the security guard standing in a corpse at the ready position, because that guy's head is no longer affixed. Man, I always hate the old standing corpse until it's touched thing. Almost as much as I hate the Final Destination hit and run thing. We get a character development combo wherein Austin and Beth talk about his late father and how she wants to keep her kids safe after having to watch him die. Then the two of them meet up with Rebecca and Paige before Jonathan stumbles into the mix all burnt up and yelling about Flegels and shit. So great, these characters finally know that there's something amiss with the banana splits. Now they just have to find out that the splits are collecting kids and putting them in cages.
We're gonna have so much fun.
Beth and Austin look for Harley in Bingo's jungle, but when Austin gets tied up in Bingo's crazy ape stuff, Beth has to turn into hot action star mom so she can save her kid from the furry.
Time's almost up.
It's actually surprising how easy it was for Beth to toss Bingo aside like that. She even de-armed the ape in the process. She and Austin find Poppy still at the side of her slain fiance, but since Beth can relate to her, what with the whole dead husband thing, she's able to convince Poppy to go with them so they can all stay safe in numbers. Drooper drags Bingo's body back to the workshop so their banana split daddy Carl can fix that feller up. But good luck getting Carl to do anything right, because he can't even keep the kids from escaping their chain link prison. And instead, he winds up locked inside the equipment cage himself. Aw, if he's stuck in there, he's gonna miss Flegel's show that's about to begin.
Sloppy time!
Yeah, it's time for Jonathan and Rebecca to get sloppy. And the splits are gonna make sure it's all captured on camera too. Flegel forces his captives to run the course as Drooper stands back there laughing like a killer clown. They get to the end of the course, but the only prize waiting for Jonathan is a prop key that Flegel jams into his back. Good work, Flegel. Just keep unlocking more kills for us like that. In fact, let's get Rebecca on the count as well. As she finishes the course, Drooper takes a hammer and smashes her frickin' head open.
He took it down to Hammer Town.
He certainly did, Flegel. He certainly did. The kids finally run into Harley's favorite split, the inimitable Snorky. But careful now, Harman. You think it's a good idea to approach the Snorkster like that?
It's Snorky. He's different.
But how can you know for sure? Oh, well, water my trunk. You know what? Yeah, looks like that's doing the trick.
Are they doing the Snorky Shuffle?
What the fuck it look like, little girl? Of course they're doing the Snorky Shuffle. Having courted the noble Snorky, the kids take his hand and walk away with him into heaven, a place where nothing ever happens. The adult survivors go to Carl's workshop, where they find the mad scientist still locked in his cage. He laughs at them and tells them that the show must go on, and sounds like it is, because now they're hearing some music coming from a basement they discover underneath a hidden door.
What's down there?
The show.
Beth, Austin, and Paige arm themselves and climb down, but before Poppy can join them, she finds Carl's prototype of Hootie, a fifth banana split that he had been in the process of designing. Poppy takes it upon herself to become the Hootie. And wow, she learns the way of the banana split's lickety-split, since she immediately gets herself a kill by swiping at Carl with some razor claws. Mother, son, and Paige make their way underground until Paige slips on some blood and discovers Doug, her fellow studio Paige, dead on the ground with Bingo's drumsticks in his eyes. Paige then looks up further to see that, oh, what the fuck? Come on! She sees, I think, 18 more bodies next to Doug. All the other employees and adult audience members from the show. It's pretty hard to accurately count them, given the multiple angles and tangled limbs, but I did my due diligence. Don't expect a gender breakdown, though. Moving on down the tunnel, they come up through the floor into a boiler room with a makeshift stage, upon which Flegel is holding court. He and Drooper terrify their child audience with a dead Stevie on a tricycle as they do some kind of fun sketch where they get to play the Grady sisters.
Now the show can go on forever and ever and ever.
While they blow Stevie's body away with a huge-ass motherfucking flame, Beth makes her way to the captive kids and tries to break them free with her monkey wrench. Before she can rescue those kids, though, Snorky shows up with even more kids to imprison. But since Harley's worked his Snorky Shuffle magic, Snorky Shuffle. The pachyderm quietly gives him a key. Drooper and Flegel bring out an all-new Wheel of Endings, with Andy the network exec attached to the spokes. They spin it, and for once, it doesn't land on Rockout. Instead, the outcome is a banana split. And if you can't guess what that means, well, you know what? You're not even really trying. Because these furry freaks rip Andy off of their saw trap, and Banana split him right up limb by tearing limb. Off all of his limbs. If it's limb one thing you've got to give this movie credit for, it's the very well done practical gore. Thanks to Snorky keys and mommy wrenches, all the kids are able to break free of their chains. Beth instructs Austin to help them get out of there, but she's got some more kick-ass mom stuff to do. Namely, beating these banana splits, silly. The animatronics eventually gain the upper hand and are all ready to torch Beth to death. But that's when Austin returns and puts down Flegel with a crowbar through the head. Harley provides Beth some assistance by tossing her his little birthday wand thing, and she uses that to kill Drooper by deploying it through his mouth. And no, sorry, the banana splits aren't going on the count. They're just a bunch of fucking robots, and they're not even trying to be human like the androids and aliens. So I don't want to hear it. Just when you think this family's safe, bingo, bango, bongo. There's a crazy ape who's come back to block their path. Thankfully, Snorky the Innocent interferes, and the two of them get into an all-out furry fight. They pretty much yiff each other to death, leaving both of them broken on the ground. Heartbroken, Harley says goodbye to Snorky, no, Snorky. Right before the elephant goes Snorky. The way of Topsy.
You'll always be my favorite.
We get one of those crime scene wrap-up shots where we see what's become of all the characters. Parker tells her mom that she wants to quit acting, Zoe and Harley become good friends, and Austin scores a kiss with Paige. Oh, and look at this, Mitch is still alive. Though not for long. Nah, that punch from Beth didn't kill him or nothing. But after all the emergency vehicles drive away, and he's left limping after them, Mitch does get killed by another Final Destination style hit and run. Damn, dude. Should have just cut your losses and limped away to be with your assistant. The movie ends with the reveal of who's driving this cart full of furry corpses. Yep, a deranged-looking Poppy, ready to be the fifth Banana Split. How many people were killed in the resurrection of the Banana Splits property? Let's find out and tra-la-la to the numbers. La-la-la, la-la-la-la.
He got a tambourine. La-la-la-la-la-la-la. Ain't no way.
From what I could tell, there were 27 deaths in the Banana Splits movie. Aside from that pile of 18 bodies, we had 8 male victims and only a single female victim, giving us a very unevenly banana split pie chart. With a runtime of 90 minutes, that left us with a kill on average every 3.33 minutes. I'll give the golden chainsaw for coolest kill to Andy. This movie's all about escalation, and his brutal death in the boiler room is the climax of this film's horror. Dull Machete for lamest kill will go to Carl, since he was partially responsible for all this madness, and yet was killed all too mercifully off screen. And that's it. The Banana Splits movie came out in 2019, and although it's a little stupid, I think it's a fun kind of dumb. If you like little kids dealing with evil AI, well, you're in luck, because next week we're finally covering the Child's Play reboot, and I've got some thoughts about it. Until then, I'm James A. Janisse. This has been The Kill Count. Thanks a lot for watching The Kill Count for the Banana Splits movie. I want to thank some patrons like Liam Ward, Toastface, Harlan Coy, Nicholas Stern.
Hey, shout out to all his patrons. Shout out to all the supporters of Kill Count, Dead Meat. You know what I'm saying? Great video as always. He had a lot of jokes in this one. But yeah, like I said, OG classic show. I was so shocked that it got made into a horror movie. Like, I remember watching the Banana Splits. Like I said, young, you know what I'm saying? Cartoon Network in my bedroom. And I was like, you know, singing the theme song all the time too. crazy amount of numbers that they took out with the film crew, the team, bruv. That's a crazy amount of numbers, fam. Let me know what y'all thought of it down in the comment section. Some brutal kills as well, especially the banana split and the lollipop down the throat. Brutal, fam. Link to the original video is down in the description. Let me know what you guys thought of my reaction. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like, comment, subscribe, hit that notification bell. Thank y'all so much for the support, guys. I really appreciate it. And I'll catch you in the next video. Peace.